Well, greetings, family. This is the day that the Lord has made, and the Bible says that we ought to rejoice again and be glad in it. I am thankful again on this Inauguration Wednesday that God in Christ Jesus has afforded us another privilege and another opportunity to be in his presence. I look forward to sharing with you again on this series that we began last week entitled A Transformed Life. We started it in Romans chapter 11 and Paul's letter to the church at Rome. He literally writes these words in Romans chapter 11, verse 33, again to 36. He says, "Oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and the knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments and his ways past finding out. For who hath known the mind of the Lord, or who hath been in his counsel, or who hath his first given to him, and it shall be recompensed unto him again? For of him and through him and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever. Amen." Last week, we talked about this whole idea of the transformed life. We talked about this question, this resounding question that many of us have: who is God? And I believe before we can be transformed, before we can be changed, we ultimately need to know the character and the person of God. None of us can truly be who God intends us to be until we truly know who God is. Paul spends time in the book of Romans to really share this idea of who God is. It starts out with the rejection of Israel, as Israel rejects the Almighty God and the gospel according to God. And as a result of that, Paul writes to the church at Rome to ultimately help them to appreciate the importance of understanding that even though Israel has rejected God, God has not rejected Israel. Paul shares with them this wonderful transformative word on how God in his graciousness is incomprehensible. We can't fully know God. We can't fully understand God, but through his scripture, he gives us an idea of how we can follow his word and live this transformed life. Last week, we talked about God's riches are beyond comprehension. We talked about the idea of knowing the riches and the things that God ultimately has in store for the people of God. We talked about the wisdom of God is incomprehensible. It is unsearchable. We talked about this idea because fully many of us have this idea that our wisdom is equal to God. And so as Paul shares, he shares this idea to help the people of God to appreciate the movements of God and that God ultimately is unsearchable. And then ultimately God's wisdom is not our wisdom. So then today I want to talk a little bit about this idea of accepting the truth of God's word, accepting the truth of God's word. Who then can know the mind of God? Becomes the first question that I think we need to ask. And then Jesus Christ is the only person who knows the mind of the Lord. When we read John chapter 1, verse 18, it says, "No one has never ever seen God. The only God who is at the Father's side has made him known." Jesus is the exegesis, the interpreter, interpretation of God. Christ alone reveals the mind of God to us. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 16, it says, "For who has understood the mind of the Lord so as to instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. No one has been the Lord's counselor." So when we look at Isaiah chapter 40, and we talked about that a little bit last week, in Isaiah's letter, Isaiah 40 and 13, he says, "Who has measured the spirit of the Lord, or what man shows him counsel?" We sometimes act as though we are qualified to be God's counselor, and we are not. Isaiah understood what the people were going through in their rebellion, and God sends Assyria, the Babylonians, into their lives. During this particular period, God helps the people of God in their rebellion to appreciate that they are not the counselor of God. Who can ultimately counsel God? And so the prophet prophet Isaiah in Isaiah 40 and 13 shares with them this important notation, this important understanding of who God ultimately is. And there are moments in you and my life where things happen and we wonder if God really understands what's going on in our lives. And Isaiah shares with them and even us today that you and me can ultimately not be the counselor of God. And so most of us, when we look at the life of Job ultimately learned this is the hard way, or learned this the hard way. And that is by satanic initiation and divine permission. The Bible says that Job suffered more than any human being ever suffered except Jesus Christ. Job's misguided friends, when you remember the story, assumed Job suffered because ultimately he had done something wrong. And if you're familiar with Old Testament and New Testament theology, you understood in this day and age that when someone's life had been beaten up, when someone's life had gone through trouble and trying times, ultimately it meant that something was wrong or some sin had gone unconfessed in their lives. And so as Job's friends come to challenge him at the place of sin in his life, Job ultimately, when you read the story, had not committed any ultimate sin. There was no hidden or unconfessed sin in the life of Job that brought down the wrath of God in his life. Job suffered ultimately because he had done what was right. Let me say that one more time. He suffers because he had done what was right in the sight of God. Scripture says that he was an upright man. He prayed for his family. He treated his children right. When he thought or had the assumption that there was sin in the life of his family or his children, he offered up sacrifices unto God as every priestly father should. So there was no unconfessed sin that we know of in the life of Job, and yet he was met with wrath, yet he was met with trials, yet he was met with tribulations. And so it helps you and me to understand and even appreciate that you can be smack dab in the will of God, and yet it will not be a vaccination against trouble or trying times. When we look at the life of Job, you remember when Job subpoenaed God for a deposition, here's what happened. God shows up in a whirlwind, but he has his own list of questions for Job. Have you ever been in that situation in your life where you start questioning God, his intent, his character, his virtue, his actions? He did something for somebody else but didn't do it for you. And Job was at that place in his life where he starts to feel like he can counsel and even question God. And so when God shows up, he shows up in a whirlwind, but he doesn't come to answer Job's question, but he has some questions for Job. Job wanted to know, here it is, God, where is God when my life is ultimately falling apart? Isn't that all of our questions? Where is God when my life is falling apart? Where is God when death knocks on my door? Where is God when the job plays out? Where is God when the family starts acting up? Where is God when I can't control my emotions and depression starts taking over? We all at one time or another have asked God these trying questions during some tribulation moments in our lives. And God ultimately wanted to know where Job was when he created the earth, when he created the heavens. God had a list of questions for Job to ultimately say, Job, you can't question me because I'm infinite. In other words, you remember in Job 42 in verse 1-6, Job responds in this way. I know that you can do all things and that no purpose of yours can be thwarted. Who is this that hides counsel without knowledge? Therefore, I have uttered what I did not understand, things too wonderful for me, which I did not know. Hear, and I will speak. I will question you, and you make it known to me. I had heard of you by hearing of the ear, but now my eyes see you. Therefore, I despise myself and repent in dust and in ashes. God does not need your assistance. Job questions God out of his pain. He questions God out of his frustration. He questions God out of his trials and the issues that had plagued his life. And many of us question God out of our emotion and out of our pain. But what if Job had paused to consider that the pain that he was going through was for the glory of God? What if Job had paused to consider that God had put him up before Satan to ultimately say that in Job, you will find a man who ultimately worships me, not for what I do, but because of who I am. And that ought to be the testimony of all of us who are listening today, that we ought to have the kind of transformative life that when we go through trials and tribulations, hardship, obstacles, boundless moments in our lives, we ought to be that testimony that when God points to us, that we don't worship him, praise him for what he does, but we praise him for the person of who he is. And when we look at that, we understand this ultimate question or this pervasive question that sometimes escapes us, and that is that God does not need our assistance. Here it is in verse number 35. Hear the words of the Apostle Paul. Or who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? This is a quotation from Job 41 and 11, where God asks Job this question: who has first given to me that I should repay him? Whatever is under the whole heaven belongs to God. He says, it is mine. This is the first principle of Christian stewardship. Before you can be transformed, you got to understand the first principle of transformation is Christian stewardship. Everything, including you, belongs to God. When you understand this pervasive idea, this ideology, this theology that we stand on, I belong to God. My life belongs to God. Everything I have belongs to God. I can't have it unless God gives it to me. Then when you understand that pervasive idea of stewardship, you understand what it is to know the incomprehensible God. You remember in Psalm 24 and verse 1 through 2, the psalmist says, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and those who dwell therein, for he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the rivers. God made everything and he owns everything. The only thing that God allows you and me to take part in is that God is the owner, but you and I are the managers. God has an expectation for you to manage your life in such a way that if he comes back as owner to retrieve what belongs to him, that you have, he has invested in you, that he has a great return. And one of the reasons why so many of us don't live a transformed life is because we don't understand the idea of Christian stewardship. Your life is a stewardship to God, not just your money, not just your children, not just your time, but your life is a stewardship to God. And God has an expectation to receive a grand return on giving you the vehicle of life. And so as Paul writes, and even the psalmist, he wants us to understand this idea of Christian stewardship. And that is, we can never place God under obligation by what ultimately he gives unto us. You cannot place God, here it is, under obligation by what we give to him, which means that you can't obligate God because you give him praise. You cannot obligate God because you give him worship. You cannot obligate God because you tithe. Because the reality is that that is an expectation for those of us who understand Christian stewardship. My body is a stewardship to God. My mind is a stewardship to God. How I treat this temple is a stewardship to God. So you can't live a transformed life, again, and I quote it with redundancy, until you understand Christian stewardship. Everything that you are is about stewardship. And when you understand that God has an expectation that you treat this body in such a way that it yields the greatest resource or yields the greatest amount of return for God, then you understand Christian stewardship. You ought to take care of your body. You ought to take care of your mind. You ought to take care of the things that God has ultimately given you. God ultimately can finance his own undertaking. Let me say that again. God can finance his own undertaking. David, you remember David, David desired to build a temple, but God would not allow David to build him a house because David was a bloody man of war, according to scripture. So instead, God appoints David's son, Solomon, who's considered to be one of the wisest of the Bible, to build this temple. God permitted David to receive the offering for the project, but he didn't allow him to build it. So the people of Israel gave generously, they gave sacrificially, and the scripture says they gave joyfully. When you go to 1 Chronicles chapter 29, verse number 14, the Bible says during this time of the temple that David prayed, and this is what David prayed, "But who am I and what is my people that we should be able thus to offer willingly? For all things come from you," that's God, "and of your own have we given you." You can't give anything to God who has everything. Let me say that one more time. You can't give anything to God who owns, who has ownership over everything. And many of us think we can bargain our way to a transformed life. We can bargain our way to real change in our lives. And so as we look at the life of David and even this letter that Paul writes to the church at Rome, he says you can't bargain with the God who owns everything. You can't bargain with God about living a transformed life or having sufficient change in your life, which means that you and me do not have the right to get angry when God does not give you what you want or takes away what you possess. If God doesn't give you what you want or take away what you possess, when you understand Christian stewardship, you understand that it all belongs to him anyway, which means that he has exclusive rights to his property, which means that he has exclusive rights to give to who he chooses, to take from who he chooses. And when you understand that priority, you understand that in this incomprehensible movement of God and in the mind of God and in the wisdom of God, you put your trust totally in him, that whatever he takes, he took it for my good. Whatever he gives, he gave it for my good. And there ought to be some of you that can type in the comments that I trust God enough that whatever he takes, he took it for my good. That whatever he gives, he gave it for my good. And because God is the owner, biblical stewardship says, I stand on the principle of his ownership and his exclusivity to do whatever he chooses to do in and throughout my life. You remember again that Job rightly said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." Now, many theologians suggest that Job was going through an era of depression, that Job was going through frustration at what God had taken from him. Keep in mind that during this season, he had lost his children, he had lost his livestock, and now he has been riddled with all kinds of health issues and boils on his skin. And now his family members and friends show up, and his friends have the audacity to start blaming all of this shortfall in the life of Job ultimately on some unconfessed sin in his life. They somehow, you know how people do, they somehow suggest that maybe Job may have not been as righteous as they thought he was. Because how could all of this befall him one after the next? It must be that he has done something wrong. And I want to suggest that Job makes this declaration not out of depression, but he makes this declaration out of biblical stewardship. Job understood that, yes, he had the children, but they ultimately belonged to God. Yes, he had responsibility over his livestock and his cattle, but they ultimately belongs to God. And so when he understood that they all belong to God, Job says, "Naked I came into it." In other words, Job said, "I came in here with nothing. I don't own nothing. Nothing belongs to me." And he says, if God decides to take it, God can take it. If God decides to give it, God can give it. And then he concludes his statement with these words, blessed be the name of the Lord. Job understood biblical stewardship so much that he understood that if God takes or gives, he'll still bless his name. Is that your testimony today? That whether God took from you in 2020 or God gives to you in 2021, blessed be the name of the Lord. Is that your testimony, no matter what's going on in your life currently today at this moment, that I will bless the name of the Lord? You remember in Luke chapter 17, verse number 7, Jesus asks his disciples these words. Will any of you who has a servant plowing or keeping sheep say to him when he has come in from the field, come at once and recline at the table? Absolutely not. In verse number 8, he asks, will he not rather say to him, prepare supper for me and dress properly and serve me while I eat and drink, and afterward you will eat and drink? Yes. But in verse 9, he asks, does he thank the servant because he did what was commanded? No. In Luke chapter 17, verse 10, Jesus concludes, so you also, when you have done all that you were commanded, underline commanded, say, we are unworthy servants. We have only done what was our duty. Now, remember, we begin this letter of Romans chapter 11 dealing with doctrine and duty. Paul moves from doctrine to Christian duty, responsibility. And so when you look at the Gospels in Luke chapter 17, Jesus walks down this idea of moving from doctrine to duty. It becomes your duty, your responsibility to have transformative moments in your life. It is a command of God for you to do certain things. And because it is a command of God, there's an expectation that out of your love for God, that you would do what God says. So again, when you have done all God has commanded you to do, God still owes you, me, nothing. That is the commentary of Luke 17. Is that when you do what you're commanded to do, God don't owe you nothing. And many of us have this reality or need a reality check in this idea that because I prayed, because I love my enemies, because I forgave, because I love my wife, because I love my children, because I treat people right, God owes me something. And what Jesus says, even to his disciples, is that's what you're expected to do. Let me see if I can help you see this a little more clearly. A couple years ago, one of my sons decided that he was going to come down and bargain with me about buying him a new pair of shoes. Came downstairs and he said, Daddy, you know, I cleaned my room. I washed the dishes all last week. I went outside and cleaned up the yard, and I make really good grades. And I was just thinking, because I do all of that, can you at least buy me a pair of shoes? It was interesting to me because on one side, I was amazed at the audacity that he had to even come and start talking to me in that tone. But secondly, I was a little frustrated because these are things that he's supposed to do. So I don't have this idea as a father that when you are commanded to do a certain set of things, I expect you to do it. There's no reward for you doing what you're supposed to do. And many of us seem to think that because we are doing what God has commanded his disciples to do, that there ought to be some kind of return for doing what God said. And God is ultimately saying to his disciples and even to us and even Paul in this transformative word to the Jews at Rome, listen, you are commanded to do this. And your command trumps any kind of reward that you expect. And so many of us have this mindset that we don't understand that everything we do ought to be done out of duty, out of responsibility, and out of the love that we have for God. And this is even more true since we have failed to do that all God has commanded us to do. And so when we understand that, you can even add this other caveat. Scripture teaches us we have all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Now watch this. When you add that caveat, that reality to our existence, that I don't deserve nothing because I'm a sinner, and I understand that I fall short of the glory of God, then we recognize that all of us are operating in the red when it comes to God and his blessings. Let me say that one more time. All of us are operating in the red when it comes to blessings and grace and mercy that God gives us. None of us deserve, I don't care how good you were last year, you're still operating in the red. I don't care how good you were the first couple of weeks of January 2021, I am still operating in the red. There should be no return on the fact that we are all sinners saved by grace. And here's the reality. Whatever favor that God bestows upon us is because of God's grace. And that's not because of your goodness. And it's ultimately because of his mercy, not because of your merit. It's his kindness, not because of your credit. Because all of our credit is below 500. None of us have good enough credit with God. How many times have you said to God, I'm going to do the right thing? How many times have you said to God, I'm going to change? How many times have you said to God, I'm going to eat better? I'm going to work out. I'm going to work this temple. I'm going to, you know, change it. I'm going to modify. I'm going to do some things so that God gets a gracious return out of what he has invested in my life. And many of us, if we're honest, come short. And so let me say to those of you who poke your chest out at how great you were last year and how great you are this year, you are still operating in the red. And so God, out of his gracious acts, helps you and me to appreciate before we can ultimately transform, we got to deal with the areas in our life that ultimately cause us not to be who God intends us to be. Let me hurry to this. The other thing I want, or idea, and the final idea I want to pin today is it affirms the extent of God's greatness. In verse number 36, Paul says, for from him and through him and to him are all things. To him be glory forever. Amen. This is a perfect summary of what I like to call Christian worldview. There's this running theme called secular humanism that inevitably fails to understand the meaning of life because it does not accept the bottom line of our existence. It ultimately is about understanding it's not about you. You remember in Jeremiah chapter 9, verse 23 to 24, hear the words of Jeremiah. Let not the wise man boast in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man boast in his might. Let not the rich man boast in his riches, but let him who boasts boast in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord who practices steadfast love. He practices justice. He practices righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight and declares the Lord my God. God is in control of all things. And God, here's it, God deserves the glory at all times. No matter how bad you feel, no matter how bad it gets, God deserves the glory at all times. You remember in verse number 36 of Paul's letter of Romans 11, he says this, for from him and through him and to him are all things. This statement affirms the sovereignty of God. It means that God, no matter what, is ultimately in control of all things. He has unimpeachably jurisdiction over all things. That means to say that God is sovereign is to say that God is God. God is in control at all times. He has full jurisdiction of all things. I like that because R.C. Sproul writes, if there were one maverick molecule in this universe running loose outside the scope of God's sovereign control, God would not be sovereign. And if he were not sovereign, he would not be God. Which means that, as Isaiah writes, God is in control of all things. Which means that Satan cannot bring destruction. He cannot bring foolishness. He cannot bring trials. He cannot bring tribulation. He cannot bring damage to your life lest God gives him authority to do so. Which means that if Satan could run amok in your life without the control and the consent of God, hear this, that means that God is not sovereign and does not have authority. God's authority supersedes Satan's intervention. Somebody ought to write that down. God's authority supersedes Satan's intervention, which means that he can do nothing to you or my life without God say so. You see it in the life of Job. You see it in the life of Jesus, his son. And ultimately, we understand that this authority that God has always trumps any of the plans and the schemes of the enemy in your life. What is it that makes God God? Here it is. Verse 36. Here's the answer. For from him and through him and to him are all things. Here is the unfolding of history, the way of salvation, the story of your life is one sentence. God is the first cause, the effective cause, and the final cause of all things. God deserves the glory at all times. Glory in my tribulation, glory in my uprising, glory in my problem, glory in my praise. Glory at all times. God deserves the glory. In his comments, I like that William Barclay says it this way. He says, if a man can say that all things come from God, that all things have their being through him, and that all things end in him, what more is left to say? Barclay is right, and some suggest that Barclay is wrong, because the fact that God is in control of all things ends the argument. If God is in control of all things, if God controls life, if God controls the universe, if God controls all things, then God ultimately has to get the glory through all things. Let me give you one more. The extent of the glory of God. Scripture speaks of the glory of God in two ways. There is an inherent glory of God that is essential for his nature. There is an inherent glory because of who God is. It is the weight of his being. It is God's brilliance. It is God's intelligence. It is God's presence. It is the sum total of God's attributes and God's character as we know it. In a real sense, the glory of God is God. You remember in Exodus chapter 33, verse 18, Moses said or pleaded, "Please, God, show me your glory." God answered, "I will make all goodness pass before you and will proclaim before you my name, the Lord. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious and will show mercy on whom I will show mercy. But you can't see my face, for man shall not see me and live." You got to see this. The glory of God beings with his goodness in the form of grace and mercy. So when we see God's glory, we see the glory of God in our lives through his goodness, and then secondly, through his mercy. There's an ascribed glory of God. We just talked about the inherent glory of God, which is God himself, his attributes, that is God. But now we talk about the ascribed glory of God. The ascribed glory of God is when we recognize the inherent glory of God, his character, and give credit where credit is due. In other words, when we ascribe glory to God, we are not making God greater than he is. That's why when we see in Psalms 34, when David says, "Oh, magnify the Lord with me," David is not trying to magnify a God who's already large. David is ultimately saying, "I'm magnifying God to you." In other words, my praise is a magnification of who God already is to me, which means that God is already large, but we can only enlarge him to us, which means that there has to be a shift in mind, a shift in attitude, a shift in focus. This is what Paul calls or calls us to, this idea of this doxology in verses 33. And then when he gets to verse 36, he breaks forth in this doxology, this praise unto God. Scripture affirms God's glory from the old to the new. You remember in Psalms 115, verse number 1, Scripture says, and I'm almost done, "Not to us, O Lord, not to us, but your name give glory, the sake of the steadfast love and your faithfulness." And then in 1 Corinthians 10, 31, it says, "So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God." That is the inherent glory of God, and that is the ascribed glory of God. Again, the ascribed glory of God is giving credit to where credit is due. So as we close this segment of the incomprehensible God, I hope that you see before there's transformation, we first got to understand the character and the movement of God. We have to understand his wisdom, his virtue. We also have to understand his glory. If you're going to live a transformed life, you must understand those three parameters. But finally, you got to understand biblical stewardship. Everything belongs to God. And when you understand the essence of who God is, and when you understand the character of God in your life, you understand that even in bad times, God gets the glory. Even in trying times, God gets the glory. But even in my sunny days, I can still praise God. And the truth of this context that Paul writes is that even in the incomprehensible movement of God, that there's still room for transformation in you and my life when we understand what God accepts and what God expects out of our lives. And the people of God said, amen. Listen, I pray you've been blessed during our time today talking about this incomprehensible God moving towards this transformed life. I pray that you understand the importance of moving towards transformation this year. Change, sufficient change by understanding God. And so I want to appeal to you, friend, if you're listening, if you're streaming with us today, I want to invite you to get to know Jesus Christ and become a part of this community of faith. I want you to know that God sends you a friend request over 2,000 years ago. God ultimately wants to be your friend. He wants to be in loving relationship with you. And I submit to you even today that you can have that relationship with God. You can have a loving relationship with God. And on our screen today, they've given you an invitation to Christ or even to discipleship. And you can join online by simply going to our website and clicking that membership tab and someone will call you immediately. I pray that God allows or you allow God to move in your life in a unique way so that you come to know him in the person of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Eternal God, we pray in a special way for those individuals who are streaming with us. We pray, oh God, that you have pricked their heart in a unique way and they'll come to know you in pardon of sin. We pray, oh God, for that person that has broken fellowship with you. We pray in the name of Jesus that you move in their hearts too so that they will come on back. Let them recognize, oh God, the importance of that you would leave the 99 and come see about the one. Father, we pray now in the name of Jesus that you touch them in a special way. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Listen, friend, we understand that we can't worship God just in our praise, but we ultimately have to worship God in our giving. And so I want to challenge you at this time to be givers. Those of you who are biblical givers here, partners with us here at New Faith Church, I want to thank you for your commitment. And then those of you who are still challenged in the area of biblical tithing and giving, I want to challenge you in that place. The Bible says, God says that you can test me, that prove me, that I will open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you don't have room enough to receive. And then for those of you who may be challenged on your jobs, you don't have a job, you don't have gainful employment, I want to pray God's blessing on you, that God will start to move in a miraculous way in your life because you have desire so that you might be able to plant a seed. Scripture teaches us that if we sow sparingly, that we will reap sparingly, but if we sow bountifully, we'll reap bountifully. You need to know, friend, that harvest time is coming. And so God has an expectation in your biblical stewardship that you would be givers to the kingdom of God. And then we want to thank all of you who participate in love gifts towards your pastor. I want to thank you personally for your kindness and your graciousness towards me. We want to pray God's blessing on this time, and I want to pray that God will continue to move on your hearts. And then ultimately, I want to thank those of you who streamed with us today. We recognize that you could have gone anywhere else and that you could have streamed anywhere else. And we pray that your time here at New Faith Church has been a great time and that you've learned something about this incomprehensible God and that you would visit us again. And then ultimately, as an entire church body, as a community of faith, we want to pray for this inauguration day. We want to pray that God in Christ Jesus would touch a new president in a unique way, and that God would even touch the vice president and their entire cabinet. And we want to pray for our economy and even our country, because we are seeing some high times in racism. We are seeing some high times in bigotry. And ultimately, in those times, we want to know that God is still the God who is sovereign and has all authority and rule. And we want to pray that we would turn our face towards heaven and turn our face towards God and pray that God will ultimately heal our lands. I pray that you had a great time with us today and look forward to seeing you real soon. Have a blessed day and continue to convey the light.